Federal prosecutors in New York said that Trump directed Cohen, his former personal attorney, to pay off two women who claimed to have had affairs with Trump in order to prevent negative publicity that would have hurt his 2016 campaign. Meanwhile, special counsel Robert Mueller described Cohen's cooperation in his investigation as useful and ongoing. In a separate filing, Mueller accused Manafort, the president's former campaign chairman, of lying to investigators about his contacts with Trump administration officials that extended into 2018. Trump hasn't been charged with anything. The question of whether a president even can be prosecuted while in office is a matter of legal dispute, and who better to throw that question to than Harvard Law Professor Emeritus Alan Dershowitz. Professor, welcome back to the Spin Room. It's great to see you.
Thank you so much. I don't think that question is really debatable, whether a president can be indicted. The Justice Department issued a ruling several years ago saying that that couldn't be done. They just can't change that ruling and apply it retroactively to a president that many people don't like. That would be such a core violation of civil liberties. It would violate the spirit of the ex post facto law. You'd have to have a very, very, very strong reason for why the old Justice Department was wrong and the new Justice Department was right. So I can assume that Mueller is not going to try to indict the president while he's sitting in the Oval Office.
So I want to discuss first the hush money first with you. Sir, if court documents show that prosecutors believe Cohen's actions were serious campaign finance crimes and that Trump was directly involved, does that not make for a plausible case against the president?
No, I don't think it does. First of all, any president or any individual or any campaigner is entitled to contribute as much as he wants to his own campaign. So if the president paid hush money for any possible reason, that would not at all be a crime, especially when you have a complicated reason. Here, the president may have wanted to prevent embarrassment to his wife and family, to preserve his brand, and perhaps also to enhance his prospects for running. When you have a complicated case like that, it makes for a very, very, very weak campaign contribution case. Moreover, if the president had filed a report about this campaign contribution, there'd be no case. And if the report was due, it was due after the election. So no harm, no foul. There's no way it could have influenced the election because the president and the campaign, by the way, it's the campaign that has the obligation, not the president, to file these reports. But if the campaign had filed it, they would have filed it after the election. So I think we're seeing the special counsel and the U.S. Attorney's Office stretch, try to find any possible justification. If it sounds familiar to Israelis, it's very, very comparable, very comparable conduct to what the police are doing with regard to Netanyahu, stretching existing laws, trying to make things into crimes that may be political sins, and it's very dangerous to democracy.
And based on what you've seen so far, could he be indicted after he leaves office?
No, I don't see any crime. A collusion is not a crime. If he wanted to build a building in Moscow, again, a political sin. What I'm afraid of is that Mueller is going to merge sin into crime. I have no such fear, by the way, with Mandelblit. I think he is an extraordinary prosecutor who understands the difference between crime and sin. But I'm not sure that Mueller understands the difference between crime and sin. The mandate is very broad and very vague and probably unconstitutional if it allows a prosecutor to write a report that basically is a political attack on a sitting president. Look, I didn't vote for Donald Trump. I'm not a Trump supporter.
Right.
I would make the same argument if it was Hillary Clinton who was president today.
Yeah.
This is a question of civil liberties, basic constitutional law, and fairness.
You know, you compared him to, made some comparison at least to what's going on with Prime Minister Netanyahu. One of the differences is that Netanyahu doesn't tweet about everything after something happens with the police or a leak. You know, President Trump tweeted today that the hush money was, quote, a simple private transaction. I want to ask you, Professor, what do you think of that tweet? And could this tweet actually complicate him?
No, I don't think tweets can become a basis for prosecution for obstruction of justice or anything else. Crimes are committed in private, not in public. Look, I've advised the president, not privately, but on television. I said four things. Don't tweet, don't pardon, don't testify, and don't fire people. He hasn't listened to that advice, obviously. I think tweeting poses dangers for him politically, but I can't imagine a tweet that could be turned into a crime if it's publicly available for everybody to see. If you don't like his tweet, answer his tweet. Respond.
Right.
But you don't make crimes out of tweets.
So Friday was a big day for the Mueller probe, filing two court documents that appear to bring the probe closer to the president. The filing about Manafort raises questions about connections between him and a figure with ties to Russian intelligence. And concerning Cohen, who met with Mueller's team, by the way, 7 times, Mueller says he, quote, he had in fact conferred with individual one, which is Trump basically, about contacting the Russian government before reaching out to gauge Russian interest in such a meeting. Yet, Professor, the president goes on Twitter saying it, quote, totally clears him. Is the president totally in the clear?
Well, I think the president's in the clear. I don't see any evidence of crime. I saw Friday's disclosures by the special prosecutor as a sign of weakness. He's destroyed all of his witnesses. Manafort could never testify in a case. He's been called a liar by the prosecutor. Cohen can't testify in a case. The prosecutor in New York says, he's a greedy guy who ought to get a long prison term. So I don't see this as strengthening Mueller's legal case. It may strengthen his political case, but I don't see him getting any closer to being able to charge the president with a crime. Now, there's some theory that he may name him as an unindicted co-conspirator. Nothing could be less fair. When Nixon was named as an unindicted co-conspirator back in the 70s when I was a kid lawyer, I complained about that, and I brought that to the attention of the American Civil Liberties Union, because naming somebody as an unindicted co-conspirator doesn't give him an opportunity to respond, because he's not going to trial. You just name him. It's like a drive-by shooting or putting graffiti on the wall of a bathroom. That's not the way prosecutors ought to operate.
Professor, if you had the president's ear or Rudy Giuliani's ear, his attorney, what would you be advising him to do right now?
Well, I've given that advice. I wrote it in a Wall Street Journal article, and I've said it on television. The advice is to demand that when the report comes out, it not be made public until the Trump team has had a chance to read it, review it, and respond to it. And then the two reports should be issued simultaneously, because if the Mueller report's going to be political and sins, then obviously there has to be an opportunity for the other side to argue that these are not sins or not crimes. That would be the fair thing to do. So that has been my advice to the president, made on the pages of the Wall Street Journal and on television, to demand an opportunity for simultaneous release of the reports, not to have the Mueller report released independently without an opportunity for the other side to rebut it.
So I know you believe there's no case for impeachment. You wrote a book about that, of course. And when the House moves over to the Democrats next month in January, how do you see this playing out?
Well, I think there will be some Democrats who will try to impeach. They've already said so. Maxine Waters not only wants to impeach Trump, she wants to impeach the vice president as well, Pence, because she doesn't like him. And her view is that impeachment is whatever the House says it is, and removal is whatever the Senate says it is. That is so violative of the framers' intention. The framers put in the Constitution specific criteria for impeachment and removal, namely bribery, treason, or other high crimes and misdemeanors, not non-criminal conduct. And they also require the Chief Justice to preside at the removal trial of a president, which suggests that this is not purely political, but there's judicial oversight to make sure that the Constitution is complied with.
We just have 30 seconds left, sir. Last question. If he needs to, could he pardon himself?
I don't know that, and nobody knows that. Nobody ever thought about that at the time of the framing of the Constitution. There were arguments on both sides. I don't think we'll ever, ever get to that. We did have a situation, of course, where the incoming vice president pardoned the outgoing president, namely Ford and Nixon. Maybe that was part of a deal, maybe it wasn't, but I don't think we'll ever get to the situation where a president has to pardon himself. It certainly won't happen in this case.